Our speaker this hour is Brother Tommy Hicks. So yes, we do have a Hick on the schedule this time. When you introduce Tommy, you have to struggle for finding nice things to say about him. See, I would agree. Tommy's a good man. We appreciate him. We haven't found out what he's good for yet, but he does a lot of meeting work as well as speaking on lectureships. He has written for several publications. He has been a part-time teacher at least at a school of preaching. He is also the large board member, the board member at large for the Gospel Journal. I don't know what that means that he's supposed to do, but have you figured that out yet? Oh, okay. He's not going to tell her. Tommy and I have known each other for many a year. It goes back from before I can even remember. Because of the association at Lubbock. And so I do appreciate him. He is a good sound man, and you know that he will stand for the truth. He and his wife Sue have 2 daughters. He is working now with the congregation in Lubbock, Texas, the Southside Congregation. He directs the lectureship and edits the book there. And that's some excellent material as well. They've had some really good lectureships. Know that he's going to do a good job on the subject, Who Shall Be Able to Stand, from Revelation 6 and verse 17.
I really thank him for that introduction, but I think you know why I'm not going to. Truly, I appreciate Michael, and I appreciate this congregation, the elders here, all the good work that you do. I had heard of this congregation many years before I had the privilege of coming here to visit, but you have never, ever let anyone down that I know of who's trying to stand for the truth and is willing to preach the truth. I'd like to just take a moment, if I may, to invite you all to come to Lubbock, October the 10th, for the 7th Annual Lubbock Lectureship. This year, our lectureship theme is The Word Became Flesh. 35 lessons will be presented Sunday through Thursday night. And every one of these lessons will deal with a biblical description of Jesus himself, or work, or a thing that he does for us as the children of God. We would invite you to come. We have a number of spaces for RVs. We even have a sewer dump. I guess that's what you call it, dump facility, or what, I don't know. But we got it. And electrical hookups, water, and things like that. We do have good motels, good eating places around. And you'll enjoy your time in Lubbock if you'll come and participate with us in that lectureship. I've looked forward to being here for some time, and I count it an honor and a privilege to have this opportunity. And I want to thank all those responsible for inviting me to be here tonight. It's an impossibility to touch upon all the material that will be required from the standpoint of an exegesis of Revelation chapter 6, especially having to do with the follow-up or the consequences that you might find from verse 17. I'm going to hit some high spots, and then we're going to deal with the idea of those who've not been able to stand and who will not be able to stand insofar as they're not being in accord with God's will. To begin with, let me just summarize to say that when you look at Revelation chapter 6, verses 12 through 17, you see a picture of those with whom God is displeased. And the ultimate question is, who shall be able to stand in verse 17, is making the point that no one who is not in accord with God's will be able to stand from the standpoint of resisting His will. In the book, you'll notice that we give some attention to the various ideas that have been given relative to the time and place that this might be as far as the consideration of the passage is concerned. We would note that brethren are certainly, well, diversified, to say the least, and many of the opinions or ideas that come from this passage are quite contradictory the one to the other. You might notice, for example, some such as Brother Byron Tidwell and Brother Don Taylor and Brother Thorley Wise Jr. will all apply this particular passage to the destruction of Jerusalem, whereas Brother John T. Hines and Rita Shelley and Homer Haley apply it to the overthrow of the Roman Empire. Brother Vernon Kaufman and, of course, the denominational scholar William Hendrickson and others will apply it to the end of time, the final judgment. Brother Kais Elkin and others apply it as a principle that can be fulfilled at any given time whenever the situation arises which is similar to that described. Then, of course, you have those such as Merle C. Tenney, Dwight Pentecost, and also John Ralphin, who are premillennialists that want to say that this has a reference to the coming of a great tribulation. And you might note, too, that some, such as Ray Summers, will say that the time and place of this particular passage are really unattainable, but you may conclude or agree with the idea, and I'm quoting Summers now, under any condition, this part of the passage symbolizes God's destructive power against those who reject Him and His plan of salvation. And certainly anyone should be able to agree with that. Now, since John, in this part of Revelation, includes kings of the earth and great men and rich men and chief captains and mighty men and every bondman and every free man, we can say that if these, and they are described as being those who are rejecters of God, one has to understand that this applies not only to nations, but also to individuals. And we need to see that as we go through our lesson for this evening. Past examples of those who are able to stand should show us something about God's will. To begin with, we would point out that the Bible, as far as the accounts it gives, has shown that God has rendered judgment upon individuals, upon cities, upon nations, and even upon the entire world at one time. And untold numbers of examples of such judgments are available if we will but look. One I'd like to note tonight has reference to King Nebuchadnezzar. And when you turn in your Bible to read concerning him and his particular problem, it's interesting to see how easily God can strike down someone who is pompous, even though he is a leader for a world empire. I want you to notice, if you will, what's stated with reference to him in the book of Daniel. In Daniel chapter 4, notice with me verses 31 through 33 in particular, but I'm going to back up to verse 30. The king, this is Nebuchadnezzar, spake and said, "Is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty?" I mean, this is one pompous fellow. He has done it all. He's a self-made man. And just as surely as he thinks of himself higher than he should, God strikes him down to show how little he really is insofar as his power and might are concerned. I like the way that this states. Notice, if you will, what is said in verse 33. "The same hour was the thing fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar, and he was driven from men, and did eat grass as oxen, and his body was riddled with the dew of heaven, till his hairs were grown like eagle's feathers, and his nails like bird's claws." Here is a man that if we saw him, we would think he is a stark, raving maniac. And in comparison to God, he's nothing. God certainly shows that men such as Nebuchadnezzar cannot and will not stand. And so we should learn that pompous governmental leaders, even today, who will not take heed to the will of God, will in due time bow their knee to Him, even though they may not wish to do so now. We might also point out the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. When you go back over to the Bible, you'll find that God's judgment against those sinful cities shows that even cities are not able to stand against Him. Look at Tyre and Sidon and Sodom and Gomorrah. Because of their evil, we're told, the Lord rained upon Sodom and Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven, and He overthrew those cities and all the plain, all the inhabitants of the city, and all that grew upon the ground. Genesis 19, 24 and 25. Now I know they give it away with a hand, but those people in San Francisco and some of these other cities that are so coddling to the homosexuals need to learn a lesson. They will not be able to stand against God in their advocacy of that which God has declared to be, well, sinful, evil, and corrupt. We would also point out that even when it comes to nations such as the nation of Israel, God's chosen people, you're not going to be able to stand against God. I like to look at the book of Isaiah from time to time to see how He shows us that He has power over nations. You might see, for example, in Isaiah chapter 13, verses 1 and 13, how He demonstrates judgment over Babylon. Or you might see in Isaiah chapter 34, verses 4 and 5, how He shows His judgment over Judea. You might notice Egypt discussed in Ezekiel chapter 32, verse 7, and nation after nation after nation. God can squash them like a gnat if they are evil and resist His will. And He did the same thing when it came to His own people, the Israelites, or as they came to be known, the children of Israel, living in the time of Jesus Christ. Jesus Himself made the declaration in Matthew chapter 23, verses 37 and 38. You see God being through with them in this. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, behold, your house is left unto you desolate. Before that time, that house, that temple, had been referred to as being the Lord's house. At this time, He says, it's yours. And now it is desolate. He is through with Jerusalem. And you find Him saying a little bit later, for then, with reference to Jerusalem, which represents all of the children of Israel at that time, for then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of time, nor shall ever be. Matthew 24:21. And all you've got to do to see that that came to pass is read Josephus' history of the destruction of Jerusalem. Every nation needs to learn by reading the Bible that it will not be able to stand if it becomes evil and corrupt. We know that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And the more evil this nation, our United States of America, becomes, the further and further away we get from God. And you and I need to realize that when we become evil enough, God will say, enough. And that will be the end of this nation, even as great as she has been and could be even now. We would point out, too, that when God looked at one time and saw that the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually, as you can see in Genesis 6:5, God flooded and destroyed all the human inhabitants and all animal life except that which was on the ark. You and I know that every man, woman, and child in the world, except for Noah, his wife, his three sons, and their three wives, were destroyed. Brethren, we need to heed what we read in 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 5 through 11. Whereas once the world was destroyed by water, it will one day again be destroyed, but the next time by fire. And we don't want to be foolish like those were to whom Noah preached, who ignored it or thought it was something less than the truth. We need to know with certainty God's word as it's given will come to pass. We would also point out that as you can look back in Bible times to see people such as Nebuchadnezzar or kingdom such as that of Israel, or even the whole world being destroyed because it couldn't stand against God and His will, we can say that there are those who are now, at least contemporaries, maybe come and gone, those that we've known are not going to be able to stand against God. I can't help but think of the atheists when we talk about this point. Isn't it interesting that there are those in our country today who want to take a phrase such as "In God we trust" off of our coinage, or take it out of the Pledge of Allegiance? Now, I've got an American flag tie on, and I'm not really political, but I want to tell you that such statements and ideas as those expressed, where people are trying to take God out of our society, those people are not friends to this country. And you and I need to be a people who will protect anyone's rights and privileges under the Constitution to practice their faith, even though they might disagree with us. We need to be a people who are defenders of the existence of God. Now, I don't endorse that false doctrine when it comes to doctrinal matters, but I understand that when we have the freedom to worship in this country, and as we strive to give all men that same freedom, that's a protection of our freedom to do so. And I think that's what we should be praying about as we see it taught in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and following. But now I'd like to talk a little bit about the atheist. It boggles my mind to go onto a state university campus and hear professors say things that are completely illogical, even though they may be PhDs in philosophy. You can go down the list, such as Bertrand Russell. Bertrand Russell wrote a book, Why I Am Not a Christian, and it sold many copies. And in that book, he explains why he wasn't a Christian. Trouble was, he didn't understand the Bible. He had a premillennialist concept that Jesus came to set up an earthly kingdom and couldn't do it. There were other things in the book that he stated, but here's some of the things he stated as an atheist. He says, now I'm quoting, "The whole concept of God is a conception derived from the ancient Oriental despotism." Let me tell you something. Man is the conception of God. God is not the conception of man. That's the way the atheists think. He made another statement. He said, "I see no reason, therefore, to believe in any sort of God, however vague and however attenuated." Well, Paul answers him in Romans chapter 1. Paul says, "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it unto them, for the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that God, or when they knew God, they glorified Him not, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imagination, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools." And of course, God has said, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. In the book, we have some references to the debate between Brother Tom Warren and Anthony Fleur. I hope you'll purchase that book and read what is stated about that. Dying with cancer, Carl Sagan wrote a book entitled Billions and Billions. I can't do it like he did. Billions and Billions. Thoughts on Life and Death at the Brink of the Millennium. It was published a year after his death. An atheist, Sagan had no hope beyond the grave. From the book that Bert Thompson wrote, he quotes Sagan saying, quote, "I would love to believe that when I die, I will live again. That same thinking, feeling, remembering part of me will continue." Then Thompson adds, "Dr. Sagan went on to note, he could not make himself believe such, and it was nothing more than wishful thinking to do so." How sad. Jesus Christ came into this world and died on the cross, shedding His precious blood there, so that Carl Sagan might have life and have it more abundantly. Instead, because Satan denied the Savior, denied the Father as well, in the final judgment, Jesus will have to deny, call Satan. Now the moral here is a proof that one doesn't have to be all that intelligent to be an atheist. She had a big mouth, and she did have a sharp mind in a lot of ways. She had enough sharpness of mind not to let anybody speak. She filibustered any time anybody tried to talk to her about the creation or about God himself, the Creator. Again, when we look at what she did, though, we have to understand that even though she didn't have the intellectual capabilities of a Carl Sagan or a Bertrand Russell or an Anthony Flew, this woman has changed the direction of the society of the United States of America. In June of 1963, because of a case that she brought before the Supreme Court in the United States of America now and since then, there has been the outlawing of Bible reading and open prayers to be said in public schools in this nation. Now, I'll be very careful here. I don't want the Catholic Church writing prayers that are to be read in our public schools. I don't want any church doing that. But from the standpoint of letting children or teenagers, or in situations such as football games or wherever else, that a public address system might be used, I would certainly say that should never be brought into question in our courts when that individual's rights or those in the audience are not being violated. And so we would make a distinction. But she has changed our nation. By the way, when you start looking at the problems we have today, you can see that they began to pick up momentum in the early 1960s. And again, I think all of these things fit together. And one day, we may be in trouble because of it. And I mean more trouble than we're already in. Well, in our book, we point out that Madam Mary O'Hare ceased to be an atheist when she died in 1995. And after December 20th, 1996, the day that Carl Sagan died, he ceased to be an atheist too. But it was too late. Bertrand Russell ceased being an atheist the day he died on February the 2nd, 1970. Again, too late. After an atheist dies, he is an atheist no more. They cannot stand. I think if people would really understand what is being said in Philippians chapter 2, they would have to understand that Carl Sagan, Bertrand Russell, Anthony Flew, Madeline Murray O'Hare, and every other atheist is going to bow their knee to Jesus Christ and confess him to be who he truly is. I want to point out too that those who persecute the church will not be able to stand. I don't know about the rest of you preachers here, but I get just as discouraged as all get out when I see what's happening to the church today. Not only from without, but from within. I do get that so-called Elijah complex. I think I'm the only one left. Especially when they introduce me like Michael did tonight. But the idea that we see the church, the trouble we see the church in today, it's discouraging. But I want you to know that it's not going to get us down because we will be victorious. Those who are opposed to the truth from without are not going to be able to stand against God. And I will tell you this, Brandon, if you think or if I think that we're the ones who are going to save the church in this present age, we are sadly mistaken. Our power is not in ourselves, it's in the gospel of Christ, and it is in Christ who has promised to never leave us or forsake us. Those who have left him and forsaken him are the ones who will not be able to stand. Paul declared, yea, and all that will live godly shall suffer persecution, as you can see in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 12. Jesus is the one who said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. That taking up the cross has to
to do with the persecutions, the trials, the afflictions, the difficulties, the struggles that we're going to have in our service to Christ. And when we face those things, we should not be discouraged, we should not be ashamed, but rather we should glorify God that we are counted worthy to be here at this time and to suffer if that is our plight. Again, Peter said, if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 16. On and on we could go, but I want to look at a Bible example or two. Saul of Tarsus persecuted the church. He could not stand against Christ. I think it's interesting, in the way that I understand the scriptures, he wasn't standing when he was speaking with Jesus, at least a part of the time. And when you find that he's in Damascus, he's not standing because the preacher tells him to arise. Why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized. Now I realize that that has to do with his physical posture. But this is also indicative of the fact that here is an individual who has submitted to the will of Jesus Christ. These words, what wilt thou have me to do? Paul wasn't going to be Israel anymore. He wasn't able to stand against the Christ. He couldn't kick against the pricks. He had to submit. And he did. Even though he was an intelligent person, even though he had some backing from those authorities of that day, he simply could not resist. He had to submit to the Christ. Time's getting away. Let me also point out that timid, compromising, fearful Christians today need to learn that they ought to be firm in their convictions and bold in their stand when it comes to the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We need members of the church like those who intimidate or intimate them by whatever means will not now nor be able later in the judgment to stand against our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Wicked brethren and false teachers are not going to be able to stand either. Apostate, evil, wicked brethren can never have the opportunity to enter into the glorious heaven above unless they repent of their warfare against Jesus Christ. And brethren, I want to say this to you. Some of our brethren, our evil and wicked brethren, who are resisting the truth and working to bring the church into apostasy, some of these people are meaner and they're more vicious than even the atheists and even those who are not Christians who would persecute the church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I've never seen, and I know this is going to be a bit personal, but I have never seen in this day and age, in my experience as a preacher, preaching nearly 40 years now, the meanness and the evil that has been directed at Brother Doug McClish by the elders and members of the present Pearl Street Church of Christ. I hope they're watching on the internet. Amen. They're evil, corrupt, vile. And they're not going to be able to stand as are others who would do the things that they're doing. When you go back into the Bible, you'll find that there were those like Hymenaeus and Alexander concerning the faith and made shipwreck. They had to be delivered to Satan according to 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 19 through 20. The Apostle Paul said about Alexander that he did me much evil. The Lord rewarded him according to his works, of whom be thou ware also, for he hath greatly restored our words. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 14 and 15. They were not able to stand against the truth and the church, which is of course the point of God of the truth, and no man will today. Warning after warning is sounded in the scriptures about the dangers posed by false teachers and false doctrines. And I am again amazed that we have so many members in the church who are oblivious to the disasters that are happening all around them in congregation after congregation. And many of these are so-called knowledgeable and mature Christians, and this includes preachers and elders. But one of our preachers said, well, I didn't know that when they talk about some of these things going on. I don't know why they don't know that. Where have they been? What book, when it comes to dealing with these matters. What book have these brethren been reading? Go on a quick survey, if you wouldn't mind, with me. How many times in Bible classes have we studied the various books of the New Testament? Let's just hit a couple of them and see if there's any kinds of warnings given, if you wouldn't mind. Look at Matthew chapter 7, verse 15. Jesus Christ says, "Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravening wolves." When you go to Luke chapter 6, verse 46, he says, "How they in vain they worship me." I'll get this right in a minute. In Mark chapter 7, verse 7, Jesus says, "How they in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." In Luke chapter 6, verse 46, he says, "Woe unto you, when all men shall speak well of you, for so did their fathers to the false prophets." By the way, isn't that what all the church members want the preacher to have now? Everybody talk good about it. Go to the community, preach the gospel, and somebody don't like it, preacher gets fired. Wow. What book are they reading? Look at Acts chapter 20, verses 29 through 31. Paul says, "For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. Therefore, watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears." Again, Acts chapter 20, 29 through 31. Can't you just hear something good brother say? Well, now, I think Brother Paul preaches the truth every time he preaches, but he is just so negative. Romans chapter 16, verses 17 and 18. Paul says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary, again, to the doctrine," notice the singular there, "which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple." Again, Romans 16, 17, and 18. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 18 and 19. "For first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear there be divisions among you, and I thoroughly believe it. For there must be also heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you." Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. "I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you to the grace of Christ, to another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you, and will pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have heard or have received, let him be accursed." Ephesians chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. "Let no man deceive you with vain words, because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them, proving what is acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness." And the verse doesn't stop there. It goes on to say, "But rather reprove them." So when somebody comes along teaching false doctrine, don't merely say, "Well, now I'm not going to have fellowship." Go again. "Brethren, be followers together with me, and mark them which walk so as ye have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who mind earthly things." Philippians 3, 17 through 19. Look at Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8. And you might notice as well, 20 and 23. Paul says, "Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, and after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ." I don't want to take the time to read all of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 through 10, but I want to read just enough of it to get the idea over. "Let no man deceive you by any means." Then he says, of course, in connection with this, in the latter part, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness and unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. In 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1, 2, and 6. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of the faith and the good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained. Then says in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 4, I charge thee therefore before God and our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and dead in his kingdom, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust they shall heap for themselves teachers, having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. Titus chapter 1, verses 10 and 11. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things they ought not, for a filthy lucre's sake. We could go on, but Hebrews chapter 2, 1 and 2, 2 Peter 2, 1 and 2, 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, 2 John verses 9 through 11, Jude verses 3 and 4, and certainly Revelation 22 and 18. And all we have done is simply test a few verses in each one of these books. We have not touched the hem of the garment when it comes to what the Scriptures teach you and me that we must do when it comes to false teachers who would wreak havoc upon the church. But I'll tell you this, false brethren, false teachers, and false doctrine are not to be tolerated. In Galatians chapter 2 and verse 5, Paul says after the first and second admonition, that the heretic is to be rejected. And again, you see that idea in Titus 3:10 tied in with Galatians 2:5. They are to be marked. They are to be avoided. And the faithful are to have no fellowship with them. The faithful are to rebuke them, to turn from them in so doing if they will not repent. And if one continues along with them, according to 2 John 11, he becomes a partaker in their evil deeds. Brethren, false teachers wrest the Scriptures, as Peter says in 2 Peter 3:16, to their own destruction. The anathema, the curse of God Almighty, is upon them, and they will not be able to stand. If the Bible teaches anything at all, it most assuredly teaches that God will permit neither false teachers nor their false doctrines to stand. Those who don't agree with false teachers or their doctrines, but tolerate them or go along with them, will not be permitted to stand either. Now I'm going to close with this particular point. Nominal and indifferent members of the church will not be able to stand. Edmund Burke is given credit for having said, all that's necessary for the triumph of evil is for enough good men to do evil. Excuse me, to do nothing. All that's necessary for the triumph of evil is that good men do nothing. That's a bunch of nonsense. Good men don't sit by and do nothing when evil is approaching. And all of these folks in the church that do nothing are not good. And brethren, with praise and elders, we need to let them know that. There is neither a neutral position nor middle ground when it comes to good and evil. Jesus made that clear when he expressed, he that is not with me is against me, in Luke 11:23. Too many members of the church think they're okay if they go to services a couple of times a week and put their money in the collection plate. But somehow they have failed to understand that they've been bought with a price, as you can see in 1 Corinthians 6, verses 19 and 20. And that price was the precious blood of Jesus Christ. They have not denied themselves, as you can see they should in Matthew 16, 24, and given God and Christ first place in their lives. Brethren, when we do that, then we will be able to stand. And those who do not will not be able to stand. Thank you.
Our speaker of this hour is Brother Ronald Hayes. That doesn't even sound right, Ronnie.
Well, my mama named it.
Well.
That's my daddy's name.